Business is a debate on motion 23343 in the name of Neil Bibby on Tide Pubs Scotland Bill. Can I invite the members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call to Neil Bibby, who is a member in charge of the bill, to speak and move the motion. Mr Bibby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I refer to my members' register of interest. This is a critical time for pubs and for all those whose livelihoods depend on the licensed trade. But the Tide Pubs Bill gives much needed hope for Tide publicans, that the sector can build back better and that overdue reform is almost here. A Tide pub is a pub required to buy at least some of its products from its pub-owning company. However, evidence that the model skews against tenants led to a campaign for reform. That campaign brought about change to England and Wales with legislation in 2015 and did so with cross-party support. The purpose of this bill was to bring that change to Scotland. The problem, as campaigners told the lead committee, is pubcos take too much of pubs' profits, leaving the tenant, the small business, unable to make a living. A publican from Renfrewshire said in written evidence to the committee that the tenant has no real control over the prices and shares of profits. The pubco restrict the opportunities for tenants to develop a viable and profitable business. Another publican from Aberdeen said, "Everyone that works in the building gets a wage, but there's been times where we don't have wages for ourselves as the expenses are too high." He estimates that he would be £35,000 to £40,000 better off if he did not have to pay excessive markups on Tide products. A camera survey of 200 Scottish Tide tenants found that 74% believe they were worse off due to their Tide. 96.5% believe a lower dry rent did not fully take into account higher costs. Only 3% had a positive sentiment about their Tide. Two-thirds were earning less than £15,000 per annum. And 99% believed the Scottish Government had to act. That's why I decided to bring forward the Tide Pubs Bill. This bill requires ministers to create a pubs code to govern the relationship between pubcos and Tide tenants and an independent adjudicator. The code would be based on three principles: fair and lawful dealing by pub-owning businesses towards Tide tenants, Tide pub tenants should be no worse off than if they were not Tide, and Tide agreements should offer a fair share of risk and reward. Part 4 of the UK's Small Business Act 2015 was the starting point for this bill, but only a start. Where possible, I've sought to improve on that act and learn from where it fell short. For example, the fair share of risk and reward principle is not on the statute book at Westminster. I included it here because I believe it will better protect tenants against profit extraction. In common with the 2015 Act, my bill gives tenants a market rent only option. That means the right to break the tie and pay a fair market rent. It does so without the complex trigger points in the UK Act. MRO rights in this bill are simpler, cleaner and automatic, eliminating the need for long arbitrations. My bill includes guest beer rights. That means tenants can stock at least one product of their choosing, helping them to respond to demand, maximising their takings and support Scotland's brewers. The bill requires Parliament to approve the adjudicator and prevents anyone with recent involvement in the industry being appointed, keeping our pubs code adjudicator free from conflicts of interest. And, Presiding Officer, should the bill progress, I will work across the chamber with the Scottish Government and other parties to seek consensus on further improvements. I want to thank the Minister, Jamie Hepburn, for listening to the voices of Scotland's Tide publicans, consumers, small business groups, unions, and over recent weeks, and for his time in which we have discussed how to progress the bill and deliver much-needed change. The committee commend the intent behind the bill, but it was disappointing that only a minority of members recommended legislation. This minority note in the report that the bill is supported by the majority of those who responded to the committee's evidence. And that's right. The overwhelming majority of evidence supported legislation, including submissions from the Scottish Licensed Trade Association, the Federation of Small Businesses Scotland, GMB Scotland, the Society of Independent Brewers, to name just a few. The committee's anonymous survey of tenants also found that 93% supported the bill. An independent spice analysis of the survey states tenants want to see a fairer split of risk and reward. Currently, there is a feeling that tenants take on most of the risk, while pub-owning businesses take an outside share of the reward. Many responses to my own consultation were supplied anonymously or confidentially. Many tenants feared recrimination. Nonetheless, Tenants did participate in my consultation, and again 93% of responses supported legislation. The committee expressed frustration at polarised arguments, and I would say there's no doubt opinion is divided. But the word polarised suggests it's divided equally. It's not. On one side, there are the interests of tenants, workers, consumers and producers. On the other, there are the corporate interests of a few large pub companies who want to remain unaccountable. Presiding officer, I also want to draw attention to two recent developments, which mean that Parliament and committee members must look at this in new light. Firstly, the Pubs Code Adjudicator for England and Wales issued Heineken-owned Stab pubs with an unprecedented £2 million fine for breaching the Pubs Code. That was just weeks after Lawson Mount Stevens, their managing director, told the committee, "We are an absolutely honourable company." Stab's headquarters is here in Scotland, but Scottish tenants have no adjudicator to protect them. The adjudicator, said Stab, did not engage frankly and transparently with its tenants, and went on to say the company must change its mindset and become proactive in its approach to compliance. How can Parliament trust them to voluntarily regulate themselves? Secondly, the UK Government published their review of the Code for England and Wales. Far from recommending a return to deregulation, ministers say in writing to the Pubs Code adjudicator, retain evidence you may come across where your existing powers are insufficient. This will allow consideration of the case for strengthened powers as part of the next statutory review. Not only is there a regulatory gap with England and Wales, but if we do not act, that gap will grow. Presiding officer, tenants of large pub companies in England and Wales have the protection of a code, while tenants of those same pub companies here in Scotland do not. That's the injustice this bill seeks to address. Fairness is the principle at the heart of this bill, and it's the principles of the bill I'm asking Parliament to support. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bibby. I now call Gordon Lyndhurst to speak on behalf of the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee. Convener, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This work is dedicated to the abomination of all that restricts travel. Almost contemporary sounding, but so reads the dedication to the book, The Thomas Cook Story, 1954 edition by John Pudney. What does this tale of the Thomas Cook Travel Company have to do with pubs? Quite a lot, actually. Thomas Cook originated as a temperance non-alcoholic beverage travel company in the wake of the Beer House Act, 1830, which was intended to establish free trade in beer. Pudney writes of the results of the act, and I quote, "The results were soon apparent. Even the poorest might keep a beer house, or let the beer house keep them. The more so when some brewers were willing to pay the 2 guineas for the license and supply stock if the house were tied. 30,000 new beer houses were opened at once. Certainly, as the act intended, more beer was drunk. Those who had favoured the measure were aghast. Sidney Smith reported, "The new beer bill has begun its operations. Everybody is drunk. Those who are not singing are sprawling." End of quote. We see from this that it is well recognised from history that parliamentary measures which relate to beer, pubs and tide pubs need very careful consideration indeed. For the consequences of such legislation can be far-reaching, in ways far beyond those imagined by proposers, promoters, or opposers alike. But before I turn from Pudney's account, I mention the son of Thomas Cook and his wife, Marianne. They named him John Mason. I kid you not. And Pudney writes, and I quote again, "The child was something of a phenomenon. The progress of the little John Mason must have been watched with especial interest." Now, no relation as far as I am aware, but we, of course, have our own John Mason, both in this parliament and often in our committee, plying witnesses with perceptive questions and thoughts for which we are grateful. For my own part, as convener of the committee which considered the bill, but who was not a member during the time when it was considered before the committee, and given my own appreciation of the benefits of the temperance movement, of which Thomas Cook was part, I am personally placed in a somewhat invidious position in this debate. To be clear, a modern favourite political catchphrase, I speak here in my capacity as convener on behalf of the committee, and on this occasion perhaps more so than at other times. The committee's consultation on the bill landed at a time of economic and practical difficulty for everyone, no less so for pub owners and tenants. The committee is very appreciative to everyone who took the time to engage with the committee despite these trying COVID times. The committee heard from a range of people in response to its call for views, online survey, focus groups, and in its oral evidence sessions. It also heard from tenants who supported the bill and those who did not. It heard from pub membership bodies and tenant membership bodies, campaigners, consumers, brewers, large and small, and the unions. The committee is deeply grateful to all of you for sharing with us your views. Presenting a bill to a committee, as Neil Beebe has done, involves a great deal of work. Members who seek to bring forward good bills are to be commended for doing so. My predecessor, Michelle Ballantyne, who was convener of the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee when the Tide Pubs Bill was introduced back in February, and during the evidence taking on the bill, should also be thanked for her good work on the committee. Evidence both for and against the bill was presented robustly. Robust is, of course, another current political catchphrase. But genuinely, views were passionate and polarised. No doubt divergence of views will echo around the chamber today, as in the committee itself, where both majority and minority views were expressed. A majority of the committee felt frustrated by the lack of complete, robust, and independent data presented by either supporters of the bill or those who opposed it. The majority were also unconvinced that there was enough evidence to suggest that there were large-scale issues in the Tide pub sector which would justify legislation. A minority of the committee felt that an imbalance between pub tenants and landlords exists and that the bill would help to redress this imbalance. The majority of the committee agreed that, although it commended the intention behind the bill, it does not support the general principles. I myself abstained. In these circumstances, Presiding Officer, I will now leave it up to others to go into the details of the bill. And I do apologise, Presiding Officer, to the Chamber, as I need to leave after my speech, and I think you will be aware that I had mentioned that to the Presiding Officer prior to now.
Breaking news, but I believe you. I now call Jamie Hepburn to open on behalf of the Scottish Government. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to begin, sadly not with the literary flair of the committee convener, but by thanking Neil Beebe for bringing forward this bill and encouraging and fostering discussion of what are very clearly important issues regarding the operation of the pub sector in Scotland. I do want to congratulate him on advancing his bill to this stage, and indeed thank him for the engagement we have had on the bill. The matters we debate today are something the Scottish Government has sought evidence on in the past. In 2016, we commissioned independent research on this subject. The evidence we gathered at that juncture was limited, and accordingly, we determined this would not be an area we ourselves would bring forward legislation on. Nonetheless, Mr. Beebe has, as his right, as of course the right of any elected representative in here, brought forward a bill, and it's incumbent on us to consider it. I want to set out the Scottish Government's support for a successful pub sector in Scotland. As Mr. Beebe and Mr. Lyndhurst have already done, I recognise the real challenges being faced by the industry at this moment in time. We are providing the support we can to ensure that we can continue to enjoy the benefits and social opportunities offered by pubs when we emerge from the coronavirus crisis. I know that Neil Bibby has been concerned for a number of years about what he considers to be an imbalance in the relationship between landlords and tenants in the pub sector. He laid that out in opening today's debate. These are concerns others have flagged as well. He has sought to address them with a bill that follows the example of England and Wales and introduces a statutory pubs code and adjudicator in Scotland, and indeed goes further. The provisions in the bill would impose new requirements on pub companies responsible for around 750 pubs operating on a tied model. The policy memorandum confirms that the number of arbitration cases and market rent only requests in Scotland as a result of this bill are likely to be very low. Fundamentally, we need to be convinced as a parliament that legislation that puts demands on business is necessary before committing to taking it forward. I've been clear throughout this process that the government supports the broad intention of the bill of fair and equitable treatment within commercial agreements. Indeed, this is something we aim to support across businesses and all business sectors in Scotland. So I've been interested to see and listen to the arguments presented during the stage one process. And I want to thank the committee for their work in assessing the evidence and presenting a clear and thorough report. Whilst I acknowledge the commitment of those who've engaged with the stage one evidence process, and I understand the strength of views, I can say that at times I have shared the committee's frustrations about the polarised nature of the evidence. It has been difficult to come to a view when opinions have been so firm on either side of the argument. But I have carefully considered the committee's report and noted their conclusion that whilst they commend the intent behind the bill, they do not agree that legislation is required and do not support the general principles of the bill. But I've also been listening carefully and I've engaged with stakeholders in order to get first-hand advice, and I've taken a keen interest in developments such as the UK government review of the pubs code and adjudicator in England and Wales. The challenge for any government is one of balancing the scale of the problem against the response required. The polarity of views, and to be frank, the lack of independent evidence that the committee identified has made the government's decision on this bill one of fine margins. There are, I believe, many strong tenant relationships in the pub sector, and these will, of course, continue. And no one is suggesting that there isn't a place for tied pubs in the overall marketplace. But clearly, there are concerns. And ultimately, we need to ensure fairness. I'm not convinced that the balance is right and the voluntary code approach is working. Indeed, the lack of awareness of the voluntary code was a concern to me, since that should be a useful governance tool. This decision has been challenging, but on balance, my conclusion is that the Scottish Government should support this bill at stage one. But I must be clear that our continued support is contingent on securing amendments to the bill, a matter I have discussed with Mr. Bibby already. The amendments that I seek involve issues such as lengthening implementation and review time scales for the code, something I believe is essential to do the process of implementing a code that's transparent, that's fair, that's properly consulted upon, particularly in the context of both the Scottish Government and industry still dealing with COVID-19. I also seek amendments to ensure the removal of elements of retrospection so that past tenants cannot raise cases long after they have left the sector, and also amendments to ensure levies and pub companies are proportionate. I want to ensure that this bill works for all parts of the sector. On that basis, I support the Tied Pub Scotland Bill at stage one, but it will be contingent on amendment going forward, and I look forward to being able to continue discussing those matters with Mr. Bibby.
Thank you. I now call on Maurice Golden to open for the Conservatives. Mr. Golden, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I accept the Tied Pubs Bill has been introduced with good intentions, although the manner in which the member has sought to progress the bill has been, in my view, inappropriate. Neil Bibby says the economy of the Economy Committee, their report flies in the face of the evidence placed before them. This is not true, in my view. The only study conducted in Scotland on the issue before the member introduced the bill was the independent CGA study commissioned by the Scottish Government. It was quite clear that no sector was significantly disadvantaged over another. Neil Bibby says 93% of respondents to his survey agreed with him, yet this was not a statistically robust survey and was flooded by responses by fellow Labour politicians and members. Neil Bibby also said Tory and SNP MSPs inexplicably want to leave tenants in Scotland with no rights at all. I believe this is factually incorrect, but it is reflective of a vexatious narrative. This contrasts vividly with the approach of Daniel Johnson in his private members bill. The bill intends to extend similar provisions to tied tenants in Scotland as exist in England and Wales. Nevertheless, there are significant concerns around this bill, primarily because the markets are dramatically different with, for example, tied pubs making up 36% of the English and Welsh market. In Scotland, tied pubs account for just 17% of the market. So this legislation will inherently be narrow in scope, raising a question as to whether there is sufficient problem for it to address. The committee report raised this very point, saying the majority were unconvinced that sufficient evidence was presented to the committee to suggest that the problem described were large scale or that there was adequate grounds to warrant legislative interference in contractual agreements. Addressing such a fundamental question must be a priority as the bill moves forward, or we risk investment and jobs, something to be avoided at the best of times, and especially during this crisis when the Scottish pub sector is on its knees. The provision for market rent only, without pre-qualifying circumstances, is, in my view, an intrusion into contract law that is hard to imagine being accepted in other sectors. It could be a serious disincentive for pub companies to invest. We already know what that looks like. Following the introduction of the Pubs Code in England and Wales, UK-wide investment from pub companies flowed to Scottish pubs, almost doubling from 6.53% to 11.66%. Unfortunately, early signs of investment flight have already appeared in Scotland, with an estimated £10 million of investment put on hold until this bill is decided. I would hope that, if this bill progresses, not one penny of investment is lost. If not, Neil Bibby will have a lot to answer for. I appreciate such outcomes are not the intention of the bill. The existing voluntary Scottish Pubs Code offers a model to avoid that conflict, giving tenants many of the rights included in the tied pubs bill, including access to independent arbitration, but, crucially, without risking jobs or investment. We have seen the essential support pub companies provide during the pandemic. For example, support with stock maintenance, wellbeing checks, and millions of pounds in rent concessions to allow pubs to survive. In contrast, independent landlords have, at best, offered mortgage or rent deferrals. If we want more pubs to survive or open, the tied pub model offers a route into running one that would otherwise require significant financial resources. So pub companies are incentivised to offer good terms to attract tenants. Numerous tied tenants have contacted me from across Scotland. They're living in fear about this bill progressing. From Bear's Den to Dundee to Clydebank to Edinburgh, their voice must be heard. If this bill does progress, I expect Neil Bibby to get each and every one of the Tide Pub tenants to support the bill, even privately to committee. If Neil Bibby's assertions are correct, this should not be a problem. The Scottish Conservatives recognise the merit in exploring these issues further, so we will vote for the bill at stage one. But proponents of the bill now have a responsibility to address the very real and pressing concerns being raised by businesses and tenants if it is to pass future stages. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Now call Sarah Boyack to open for Labour, please, Ms Boyack.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I want to thank Neil Bibby, his team and the Non-Government Bills Unit for the huge amount of work they've done in getting us to this Stage 1 debate today, and all of those who gave evidence to the committee in advance of the report. And the Minister said this afternoon that we need evidence that we need this bill. And I think he's absolutely right. That should be the case with every piece of legislation we put through in this Parliament. And for me, there's an incredibly straightforward set of principles behind the bill and a strong argument for us passing it today. Moreover, we're playing catch-up, as Tide Pub tenants in England and Wales have had rights for 4 years after cross-party agreement was reached in the UK Parliament. And as the FSB clearly stated in their evidence to the committee, we see no reason why Tide tenants in Scotland, who form a key part of an industry that contributes £1.7 billion to the economy every year, should not be afforded the same legal protections as those in England and Wales. I think that's a key principle. But we can benefit from the experience that there has been in England and Wales. And this bill is not identical to that which was passed with cross-party support. That's the opportunity of the Stage 2 process. As STUC and the Scottish Licensed Trade Association have said, this bill is in the best interest of Scotland's workers and Scotland's businesses. And CAMRA, the Campaign for Real Ale, have put the case for Neil's bill very clearly. The current tiered system in Scotland is unregulated by legislation and is creating an imbalance of power as pub companies develop a monopoly over the supply and cost of Tide products, leaving licensees paying an increasingly high prices for a restricted range of stock. So I think there's a case for legislative action. But as I say, the bill is not identical to the UK legislation. There's been the opportunity to learn from experience. There's the fact, as was mentioned already, there's an arbitration process which should be shortened and simplified, which enables both disputes to be raised by tenants and pub-owning businesses. And the concerns that Maurice Golden raised, I'm glad that at the end of his speech he said they would support it to take it to stage two, but I do think it's important we look at the evidence and look at what's in the bill that Neil Bibby has proposed. A principle that Tide agreements should provide a fair share of risk and reward. I think that's absolutely appropriate, and that the proposed judicator requires parliamentary approval to ensure that the Parliament's confident there's no conflict of interest. There's some key legislative principles we should be able to support. Scottish Labour's been campaigning over recent months for practical support of our small businesses in the hospitality sector. It's devastating for publicans who've built up their business from scratch, investing their energy, serving customers, and having to invest everything they have to keep their businesses afloat. But I found it shocking to read that in a survey by CAMRA, that Scotland's Tide tenants, three quarters of them were worse off because of the tie, and 96.5% believed their reduced rent did not take into account the higher prices they paid for their Tide products. So we do have evidence, and we've got the Heineken decision just a few weeks ago. There are wider impacts on the Scottish economy we need to think about too. It's not just the pubs, it's the small brewers who are not able to access the Tide pub sector, given the minimum volumes needed, the discounts and the logistics required by large wholesale pub owning companies. So there's time for people to sit down together, look at what's in this bill and make it work. Look at the principles and look at the principles of fairness. The bill would also give consumers greater choice, as Tide tenants would be able to stock a beer of their choosing. Now, I do think the evidence to the committee was overwhelming, but look at who's supporting it. The SLTA, Tennant Caledonian Breweries, the Society of Independent Brewers, the Scottish Tourism Alliance, GMB Scotland, the FSB, the STUC, the Pubs Advisory Service, the Campaign for Pubs, the British Pub Federation, and the Forum for British Pubs. That is really important support. And I think the comment from FSB that the impact coronavirus has had on pubs is a timely reminder of the fragile business conditions. That's why we are supporting this bill. It's the second time we've supported a bill with Scottish Labour where we've brought forward a bill to improve the lives of people in Scotland. I'm delighted that the SNP government is now going to work with Neil Bibby and with the committee. This is important we get this into legislation to accept a vision for change and to stand by the Tide pubs who deserve a fairer deal and to aspire not just to survive the pandemic, but to be part of the Build Back Better that we should all be supporting in this Parliament. So I hope that we will pass this today, and I hope there's a constructive approach at stage two, because this bill could transform opportunities in the sector. It will help in terms of jobs. It will help in terms of the supply chain in Scotland, in terms of creating jobs in the brewery industry, and it will give better choice for consumers. That's why we're supporting it, Scottish Labour and the Scottish Cooperative Party. We want to make sure that this is an opportunity that this Parliament seizes with both hands and listens to the evidence, acts on that evidence, and learns from the experience of legislation that was passed 4 years ago that has worked, but that we craft it to meet our conditions in Scotland. That should be what we do
please
next.
Please conclude.
Thank you very much, Presiding
Thank
Officer.
Thank you. I now call Andy Whiteman over to the Green Party. Mr. Whiteman.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. And I, too, commend Neil Bibby for introducing this bill, which Scottish Greens do believe provides for a proportionate and fair intervention in the relationship between pub companies and Tide tenants. And as a member of the committee that scrutinised this at stage one, I thank all of those who gave evidence to the committee and those who have sent briefings over the past few weeks. Pubs, as others have said, are part of the social fabric of our communities across Scotland, and there's been a marked increase in pub closures in the last few decades. And this year, that's only going to be exacerbated by the ongoing pandemic. And committee, we heard from pub owners, tenants, drink suppliers, various trade bodies, and the opinion of those who gave evidence to the committee were indeed polarised, with those in favour believing they're not getting a fair deal, and those against believing that it will damage the pub industry in Scotland. Some Tide tenants are indeed happy with the current setup, and it's unlikely that these tenants will want to take advantage of any of the provisions in the bill, though I'm sure they will be pleased to have the backstop protection of a statutory code. There are those who are not happy, however, and Neil Bibby articulated directly some of their evidence, and who are seeing low returns for the time and effort they put in and being forced into poverty as a result. There's a great deal of risk for the tenant in far too many cases and very little for the owners. One pub company, Hawthorne Leisure, identified £25,000 as an acceptable income for pub tenants. Now, of course, pub tenants are often a couple. Indeed, that's often the preferred arrangements by pub companies, and they'll often work every day of the week. There's a real danger that some of these tenants are not currently able to pay themselves even the minimum wage. By contrast, in 2019, Hawthorne Leisure Limited reported a £21.2 million profit. So there is a power imbalance between tenants and landlords, and it is legitimate for Parliament to alter that relationship in favour of either of the parties, in this case, in favour of the weaker party. Now, Maurice Golden said in his speech that we shouldn't interfere with private contracts, but there are few, if any, contracts anywhere in the developed world that are not framed, that are not agreed within a statutory framework. And we legislate in these frameworks all of the time, whether that's the contract between a landowner and a farming tenant, a landlord and a tenant in a house, company law, contracts and licenses entered into between regulators and utility companies, etc. This is a normal thing to do. Now, pub tenants are personal guarantors for their businesses, often having to put up their home and other assets. They're then charged rent and often an inflated product price with little freedom to choose their own stock. And so the proposed requirement for ministers to establish a Scottish pub code would address this imbalance. Providing people with fair work that provides them with an acceptable standard of living shouldn't be something that's up for debate. And this should be one indeed of the key principles of the code when it's designed, and I support the regulatory principles as drafted in the bill. And the member has also taken note of the loopholes that were exploited when the 2015 Act was brought in England and Wales, and ensured that the bill here is robust and not able to be exploited in the same way. I do regret that the committee stage one report recommended against the general principles of the bill. Most committee members took the view that because evidence was sometimes in conflict, they were not persuaded that legislation was needed. Presiding officer, the job of MSPs is to take evidence and apply their judgment. Where evidence is contradictory, it needs to be assessed, weighed and used to form a judgment on the merits of the proposals. And that's what I did. It's why I'm pleased that the minister is not persuaded by the committee's recommendations and is willing to support the bill at stage one and to work with the member on the way forward. Presiding officer, Greens will be supporting the bill this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Whiteman. And I call Willie Rennie to open the Liberal Democrats. Mr. Rennie, please.
I can't let this go without comment. I want to commend Maurice Golden for his contribution earlier on. He attempted to demolish the bill in his whole speech before indicating that he was going to endorse it at decision time tonight. It was quite an extraordinary contribution that I think we all have to just dwell on for a moment. Pubs are community assets. They are important employers which need to be protected and get a fair deal. They also play an important role in showcasing the world-class products that Scotland makes. Through this pandemic, we probably value pubs even more as we are deprived access to them. And in the words of Joni Mitchell, you don't know what you've got until it's gone. I genuinely do fear that many pubs could be gone as a result of this pandemic. So whatever we do with this bill today, this must not be the last word on pubs. And I hope the members will forgive me for blowing the Liberal Democrat trumpet just for a moment or two, because former Liberal Democrat MP Greg Mulholland was a champion for the sector for many years. And through his hard work and diligence, the landscape of the pub sector in England and Wales has changed. That was backed up by my colleagues Vince Cable and Joe Swinson in government, who introduced the Pubs Code and the Adjudicator. It governs the relationship between the large pub-owning companies and their tiered tenants in England and Wales. And I would argue that it's changed the landscape for the better. And I want to praise Neil Bibby for his enthusiasm. I expect him to be hiding around every corner every time I turn up at Parliament, so enthusiastic he is to sell me the merits of the bill. But we will be supporting the bill today, not just because of that enthusiasm, because of the merit of exploring this further. I think it is important that we look at the balance between the relationship between tied tenants and their pub companies. Yes, the profile of the sector in Scotland is different. Yes, there are a smaller number of tied pubs. Yes, it may provide a way for new tenants to the sector to hone their skills and knowledge and climb the ladder to their own pub. But the significant support that the bill has received is an indication that there could be a significant problem. The support from a range of trade organisations and trade unions cannot be ignored. And I have to say, Neil Bibby's powerful evidence, the statistics that he provided about the challenges on the finances, I think means that it's important for us to take this further, to give tenants more freedom to be creative and to give them a better standard of living must be considered an objective worth getting behind. So having a pub code adjudicator, an automatic right to a market rent only option, and for this to cover all tied pubs seems like a package worth exploring further. Sometimes the sign of a good law is if it's actually not used very often. So I'm not convinced by the argument that because the adjudicator in England and Wales has not been used very much means that it's not worth it. That ignores the change that has been introduced into the sector in response to the presence of that adjudicator. Look at the changes that Neil Bibby has already managed to achieve in Scotland just by launching this bill itself. Of course, there's the voluntary code of practice led by the industry, but there's a new Scottish governing body with representatives from tenants and pub companies themselves. And there's the low-cost arbitration process that's now going to be promoted properly in Scotland to Scottish tenants. These are just changes without the legislation in place. So we need to look at this bill. We need to consider whether we can go further and change the balance between the companies and their tenants. Of course, we need to be careful. I do welcome the Minister's remarks this afternoon that he will work with the member to make this bill better, and therefore we will support the bill at decision time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rennie. And we move to the open debate. I call Colin Beattie to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to have the opportunity to take part in this debate on Mr. Neil Bibby's proposed Tide Pubs Scotland Bill. And firstly, I'd like to thank and congratulate Mr. Bibby and his team for their work in bringing this bill forward. As a member of the Economy, Energy and Fair Work Committee, I've obviously had a fair bit to do with examining the evidence for this proposed legislation. I have to say that I, along with others in the committee, were extremely sympathetic to the purpose of the bill. It was clear that the intention was to create a level and fair playing field for all participants in this important sector within our hospitality industry, an industry which creates substantial value to the economy and employs a significant number of workers. There's around 4,000 pubs in Scotland, and out of these, 750 operate on a Tide model, which is about 17%. As members will be aware, the committee took a majority decision to not support the general principles of the bill. It did, however, commend the intention behind the bill. And I have to say that from the beginning, I felt that some members of the committee, like me, were ambivalent as the evidence taking progressed. And the reasons were quite simply that it quickly became clear that there were two sides to the debate on the bill, and both sides deployed information and statistics from their own sources. And often this information was seen to be in direct contrast and even contradictory to the other party's position. And members of the committee, I think, were sometimes left uncertain which information had greater validity and which revealed the correct position. The lack of independently produced or auditable information was extremely disappointing, and added to the reservations which some members held about the true situation. Lacking this information, the majority of members felt that the bill lacked a sound basis on which to be supported. And I think that some members also felt that before lending support to something as important as this bill, it was necessary to have strong evidence suggesting it's the right step to take. Some effort was made to draw comparisons with the situation south of the border, where a somewhat similar situation had existed and where legislation had been introduced along the lines of that proposed in Scotland. Closer analysis, however, to me, did not support clear comparison due to different market practices and basis of legislation. Notwithstanding these issues, I think some members of the committee were concerned at evidence which was presented on a variety of subjects, including reports that 10.5% of tenants were surviving on incomes of only £10,000 a year or less, while 54% were reported as having incomes between £10,000 and £15,000 per annum. Clearly, that's an unacceptable income level, which does not recognise the hard work which pub tenants put in to make their businesses viable. Yet it was not possible to drill down in these figures in order to make sense of them and the context in which they were couched. It was also suggested that moving to a market rent-only relationship would improve income levels for pub tenants, while increasing the choice of beers and other pub offerings for customers. However, given the alleged income levels which I just stated, it's difficult to see how that might benefit pub tenants on such limited income levels. Their access to capital would appear to be limited by the resources at their disposal. Pubco has made a strong pitch that their financial strength and willingness to invest in tenants' pubs provides support for their businesses, which they might not be able to resource themselves. There were complaints that consumer choice was constrained due to lack of choice of products in Tide pubs, and both sides deployed arguments seeking to confirm their positions. We looked at statistics on pub closures, but without more detailed supporting information, it was difficult to assess whether this was caused by reason of the pubs being Tide or because of market and pandemic forces. There were allegations that for Tide tenants, the price of stock, particularly beer, was inflated by the pubco. There did seem to be some evidence of this, but again, more information would have been helpful. These are just a few of the reasons why I believe that this bill is not quite ready as it is, though the sentiment behind it is definitely a genuine one. So where does this leave us? And the result seems to be firmly in the not proven area, rather than coming clearly down on one side or the other. So I stand here somewhat ambivalent and possibly a little uncertain. But this is a bill which is clearly well-intentioned, but lacks the definitive and decisive information to make it absolutely clear in my mind to back unreservedly. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to bring amendments to this bill, which I trust will address my remaining concerns.
Thank you very much, Mr. Beattie. And I call Daniel Johnson to be followed by John Mason. I urge members, 4-minute speeches if possible, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by congratulating Neil Bibby on bringing forward this, I think, very well thought through bill. I know, obviously, that it takes a great deal of effort to get a bill to this stage. But I think I'd make the general comment on this. I think in recent weeks, we have seen a number of members' bills come forward. And I think they demonstrate the strength of this place, that we have a strong system of members' bills. And I think it can lead to, more interesting policy-making and a true opportunity for parties to come together in a consensual manner to make better policy. And on that, can I just slightly take issue with the government? Not because I don't welcome their support, but only confirming yesterday that they were supporting this bill, I've had to rapidly change my bill that was full of condemnation and cries of injustice and acknowledge support. And the minister knows that I struggle to say good things about him in public or in private. And 24 hours notice has been quite some time pressure to think of such things. And I will give way on that note.
Jamie Hepburn, Minister.
I wasn't quite aware of what Mr. Johnson said about me in private, but I hope this encouraged him to approach these things with a more open mind in the future.
Daniel Johnson.
I will take that in mind. He might want to ask some of his colleagues about the things I say about him in private. But in all seriousness, I think the comments he made at the beginning are important, because it's not always the case that survey results or simple consultation responses can point unequivocally to where good legislation should take us. I think he's absolutely right that sometimes policy is about making judgments and it's about principle. And on this, I think it is about the principles of what is required in terms of the way markets operate and the way small business owners are able to run their businesses. Which brings me rather to the points that Maurice Golden made. First of all, he said that only 17% of pubs have such forms of tenure. Well, I would suggest that to those 17%, this is incredibly important legislation. But in terms of well-functioning businesses, well-functioning markets, if he thinks that restrictive supplier arrangements are a good way for businesses to run and to have a flourishing market, well, I think he needs to look a little bit harder about what it actually takes to run a small business. So let me tell him, as somebody who has run a small business, somebody who has had to negotiate relationships with suppliers, it is incredibly difficult. It's incredibly difficult running a small business when you're up against much bigger businesses, and the only advantage you have is your ability to be flexible, to make quick decisions, and to put different products in your business and make those available. By choosing what suppliers whose products you sell in your business to offer something distinctive. And by having practices such as these that restrict small businesses' ability to choose those different products, to offer something new and distinctive, you are doing something incredibly unfair. And that is very much the situation these pubs, these small business owners, find themselves in. There are hundreds of pubs finding themselves in these restrictive leases. And as a shopkeeper, I just simply find that situation incredible, that by dint of your lease, you can be restricted in the suppliers whose products you can buy. That just seems simply unfair. It's, in fact, unthinkable for me, coming from one type of business, looking at another. And indeed, the fact that the products that they're supplied are 50% more expensive simply, I think, makes the case for change. And I think, well, Willie Rennie put the point very well. It's not necessarily about how frequently legislation is used. It's the fact that it can be. And I think that the very fact that there would be an opt-out would change the negotiating position between the tenants and their landlords and dramatically change the situation for these businesses. And on that note, I'll close. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. And I call John Mason to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I have to say, this was an issue which first came up to me when I was in Parliament in England, and I have to say I was impressed at that time with the work of Lib Dem MP Greg Mulholland, who has been mentioned. He was pushing for this kind of legislation, and I think was instrumental in its happening down south. The question was whether we needed a similar bill in Scotland, and I think it has been agreed that there is a problem here as well, but it's on a much smaller scale than in England. One school of thought, obviously, is that England is bigger and better than us, so anything they do, we should copy. I think that is what happened with the Lobbying Act to some extent, which was not so much of a problem in Scotland, but we didn't want to be left out. The Scottish Government carried out research published in 2016, which concluded, amongst other things, that no part of the pub sector in Scotland appeared to be unfairly disadvantaged over others. So all through this process, for a number of years, there seems to have been a lot of uncertainty. I was not on the Economy Committee when they took the evidence and did most of their work on this bill, but I did come in as they were working on the report. It became evident to me that the claims made by both sides were wildly conflicting, and the committee had struggled to find out what was really happening. On the one hand, the PubCo model does seem to work in some instances. I have a couple of what were really scruffy pubs in my constituency. There was then significant investment by Heineken Star with the active participation of the tenants, and both these pubs have both really improved tremendously. I do not know if that would have happened under a different model. However, I know committee has also heard from tenants who felt they were caught in a trap with no way out. And I see pubs in my constituency with no Scottish beer at all. And this despite the fact that we have West and Drygate breweries in the East End of Glasgow. As a beer drinker, I see that as a problem. However, the question is exactly why is this happening? We are not clear. One of the areas of contention amongst witnesses was around what the actual income is of Tide pub tenants. The committee looks at this in paragraphs 28 to 38 of the report. There are a number of phrases that were used, like income, earned, take home, pay. And these can mean different things to different people. Both Alison Harris and myself asked at the committee if we had definitions of these, and I think the committee did not get that, was not provided with audited accounts, or similarly independently verified financial statements to substantiate the various claims. So overall, it seems to me that the case is not proven, as Colin Beattie has already used that phrase. Yes, there is a problem to some extent, but the committee, including myself, was not convinced it is a large-scale enough problem to warrant legislation. In passing, I would just say that I think that's why we need the not-proven verdict in the courts, where there is not enough dependable evidence to say who is guilty and who is innocent. So given the lack of conclusive proof, as far as I could see, the question is, which way should Parliament go on this? Often you would not legislate in a matter where the need was as uncertain as it is here. However, there clearly is a lot of support for the bill, and I understand it is likely to get enough votes tonight to proceed. For myself, I remain somewhat sceptical, and given my involvement in the committee report, I will be abstaining at decision time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm going to start by expressing my sympathy for the principles that are in this bill. My grandfather will be spinning at a high rate of knots in his grave, as he was a member of the Society of Rechabites, which was a home for people who were teetotalers and campaigned against the evils of drink. But that was a long time ago. But I have very significant issues about the way in which the bill was drafted. I've come to this relatively late, and my starting point is always to have a look at the bill. And the first one I address is relatively straightforward and simple one, which can easily be remedied, and that is on page one, where the regulatory principles are stated as the principle of fair and lawful dealing by pub-owning businesses. Well, it's extraordinary that a piece of legislation should legislate to say that people must obey the law. So I would simply take those three words out. But that's a comparatively trivial matter. I think there are bigger issues when we look at the definitions of Tide pubs on page 8 at paragraph 20 and indeed section 21, where we define what a tenant is and what a pub-owning business is. I'm sort of taken to what happened after the 1991 Agriculture Act, where we saw the introduction of limited partnership as a way of bypassing the provisions of that act between the owner of the land and the tenant. The owner could terminate at any time. And I think the way in which this is drawn has similar difficulties if you were to have pub-owning businesses that wanted to act in the way. For example, it might be possible to say that if you want to operate a pub that's owned by someone else, you have to become a shareholder in a shared company. And that would not create the landlord-tenant relationship, which this bill relies on, but would still create the opportunity within that company organisation that you've established to create a dependency that people have to buy their beer from a particular source. The second thing that one might do if one wanted to thwart the way in which the definitions currently operate, it might be to operate through a subtenancy, in that the subtenant, the tenant be allowed to create subtenancies. And it appears as the bill is currently structured, that might break the link upon which it depends between the landlord being a pub-owning business and the tenant, because the subtenant would not necessarily be a pub-owning business. Indeed, they are merely a tenant of another company. So I think there are some practical difficulties. But of course, that doesn't mean we should vote against the principles of the bill if our judgment is that it's possible to amend the bill at stage two and stage three to remedy these. And I think some rather substantial other difficulties there are in the bill. Because when I look at something and I find such straightforward ways of thwarting the means of this bill, I'm not saying I carry with me quite considerable doubts. But then my ingenuity as a non-legally qualified person is substantially less than that of others. So I hope that Parliament will look at this bill very carefully as it proceeds through stages two and three, as I expect it will. I support the principles and will vote for it with some reluctance at decision time tonight. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stevenson. And can I call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Sandra White? Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're having this debate against a backdrop of the most severe crisis ever to have faced our hospitality sector. Pubs are on their knees. In many parts of the country, including my own, you can't even go to one if you wanted to. And when they're allowed to reopen, many won't. For those of us who like the occasional pint and who like the variety that we have in the sector in this country, it's deeply depressing. This bill was introduced in better times, but even then, pubs were struggling. And I wonder if Neil Bibby would have introduced the bill today. It's a well-meaning bill, no doubt about that. It follows the legislation in 2015, England and Wales, to create a pubs code and an adjudicator, which would govern the relationships between some tight pubs, tenants, and their pub owning company landlords. The Tide Pub Scotland Bill aims to ensure that Scottish Tide Pub tenants have at least the same protections and opportunities as those covered by the 2015 Act. You would think all that is fair enough, except that the Tide Pub sector is nowhere near the size in Scotland as it is in England, 17%. So if there's a problem, it's a small one. I'd like to commend the committee for its work on the bill. They've come up with a pretty fair summary of it. To quote, the bill will ensure that Tide tenants have the option to request a market rent only lease. This means that a tenant can pay the going market rate to rent the pub without having to buy products or services from the pub owning business, therefore ending the Tide relationship. Even if a tenant remains tied, the bill provides an opportunity to sell at least one guest beer. They will not be restricted to only selling the brands permitted by the pub owning business. This bill has only got people excited if my inbox is anything to go by recently. As we've headed towards this debate, really, it's finely balanced. It's not cut and dried. You can argue this any way. And as the committee said, views on the bill are polarised. Those who support the bill argue that there's an urgent need for legislation to rebalance the risk and reward in tied tenancies. They believe that the pub-owning companies take too large a share of profits, meaning that tenants struggle with low incomes. Opponents, think there's no need for legislation and believe that the Thai tenancy model already works well. Not only do they believe that legislation is unnecessary, they think it would actively damage the pub sector in Scotland. Those who oppose the bill argue that it would harm investment in the sector and force pub-owning businesses to manage pubs themselves or sell them. And that's quoting from the committee report. That latter point has been made quite forcefully as we've headed towards this debate. It was no surprise to me that the committee was divided on the bill. As I said earlier, I don't think it's cut and dried. I don't think it was helpful to read the comments of Neil Bibby when the committee report came out, in which he said, quote, the SNP Tory majority on this committee got it wrong. Their report flies in the face of the evidence placed before them. SNP and Tory MSPs have sided with big multinationals who are extracting profit from small businesses that need our support. I think those comments were slightly insulting to members who have sided with no one and were wrestling with some pretty serious issues. Presiding officer, if this bill does progress to stage two, the committee has a big job to do. I have every confidence that they'll get it right. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Simpson. And I call Sandra White to be followed by Bob Dorris. Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm not a member of the committee and really take task with Neil Bibby's comments. In fact, as a member for Glasgow Kelvin, it covers Glasgow City Centre, the West End and beyond, with many, many pubs in that area. And in fact, the reason I've got a particular interest in this bill is because a number of years ago, I attended, along with Neil Bibby and Mr Mulholland MP, a number of events in the Scottish Parliament in regards to Thai pubs. And I must say, the comments at that particular time or the views were very mixed. And they're still very mixed now. So I'm coming from this from constituents, and the pubs are in my area. And I did mention just there, I do represent an area with many pubs, from large to small. And last night, I received, apart from other emails regarding this bill, last night I received 19 submissions from local publicans in regards to the bill. And the whole of the 19 of them were against this bill. So I'm just putting that in context. And I want to pick up on the contribution that's been mentioned already today. And they mentioned the protection that the bill would give to people running Thai pubs. And I do take on board some issues that people have raised with me regarding costs, maintenance, perhaps repairs as well, and some protection that may be needed, but that would need to be looked at. However, others have mentioned it too. I was under the understanding that Scotland had an independent dispute mechanism, which from reading through it would appear to provide much of what this bill, which is a proposed, would bring forward. Another issue I wanted to raise, and it has been raised with me, is the establishment of an adjudicator paid for by a levy on the pubs. To me, that's a huge concern, and it's certainly a huge concern for the constituents who run the pubs and the pubs in my area. Now, I do want to give some context to the in respect to this bill, and others have mentioned it already. Thai pubs make up 17% of the market, and that's 750 pubs in Scotland, compared to England and Wales, where it's 39% of the market, and nearly 20,000 pubs. And the majority of pubs in Scotland operate under the independent free trade model. 64% actually operate under that, and there's 13% are managed and 5% are pubs which are leased and tenanted with no tie agreement. Now, if we are to go forward from stage one, and I'm minded to support at stage one to look at more evidence, we must, if we're going to look at it properly, we really must take the figures that's been mentioned by myself and others. We need to take that into account because there is a really polarised argument here and people are either for or against, but the majority who have contacted me from my constituency are very much against this particular bill in this area. Now, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to ask, I don't know if Neil Bibby can answer this, or perhaps the Minister can answer this. I would like to know, if this bill does progress and becomes law, that no one will be compelled to change their arrangements if they find the model they have chosen, Tide Pub or otherwise, is effective for them. It's about the publican, it's about their choice, and I'd like to know if someone can answer me that tonight or later, if that would be the case. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms White. And I call Bob Dorris before we move to closing speeches and James Kelly. Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was sympathetic to this bill, but I awaited the committee stage one report and it was indeed finally balanced. It initially appeared to be a very straightforward bill, but as I took time to read the briefings, it's clearly more complex and uncertain as the issues are explored. I suspect there will need to be some significant amendments at stage two should it progress here this evening. And I'd like to make a few observations. For instance, the debate as to whether there's a need for the legislation in the first place. I'd be struck by the anonymised survey of Tide Pub's tenants, which Spice arranged for. They found a majority of respondents felt the bill would improve the relationship between pub-owning businesses and tenants. I can understand that given the contractual relationship between tenants and pub-owning businesses, that tenants are most likely to give a frank response, a clear response, when that response is anonymous. I therefore place a significance on those findings. It was also of interest to see the significant variance in the estimation of the income of Tide Pubs. Camera, based on a telephone survey from 2014, estimated that could be as low as £10,000. I find that staggeringly low. The British Beer and Pub Association estimated average incomes was around £38,000, and that was in 2019. Hawthorne Leisure helpfully informed the committee they aimed for minimum earnings of £25,000 for tenants. They may be one of the better pub-owning businesses. I have no idea. I can't comment on others either. However, I do note that 10 of their tenants contacted the committee indicating that they opposed the bill. That, of course, may indicate the views of the tenants on the need for the bill will depend on how well they feel they are treated by the pub-owning business in the first place. Surely that is a reason to have a statutory Scottish pub code with arbitration and enforcement to ensure that protection and good practice exists right across the Tide pub sector. I was also interested to examine the debate around whether the bill should include a provision for tenants to have a market rent-only option. I understand the nervousness of pub-owning businesses in relation to this, to remove the ties and offer maximum flexibility for tenants. If the flexibility gives tenants a greater chance to grow their business, to strike better deals and improve income, that would be at the expense, perhaps, of the pub-owning business. Of course they're going to have issues, that's self-evident. But, however, that would also provide a significant incentive for the pub-owning businesses to demonstrate the benefits of that tie to existing tenants. Therefore, even if very few tenants opted to consider a market rent-only option, if that's progressed within the bill, it may drive positive change nevertheless. Regarding allowing tenants to source a guest beer directly also concerned pub-owning businesses. Spice indicated that if this was a standard lager, as it was termed in the briefing, I suppose that means a house lager, would constitute about 38% of all beer sales within a pub. Undercutting lager supplied by the pub-owning business will, of course, boost income for the tenant and impact on the pub owner. I suppose at the end of the day, this is the right thing to do. I support the principles of the bill. I do want to ensure tenants have adequate rights, protections, and hopefully, and importantly, boosted incomes. We do have to ensure the balance of rights, of course we do. And when we extend protection to Tide Pubs, it does not stifle new entrants into the sector or the expansion of smaller businesses, that the levies and fees are appropriate, and that the extension of market rent only rights and guest beer flexibilities, if they're taken forward, are done in a way which sees pub owning businesses as partners and benefits the entire sector. So I absolutely support the general principles here this evening, but lots of work to do at stage two, I suspect. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thanks very much, Mr. Dorris. And we move now to closing speeches. James Kelly to be followed by Dean Lockhart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Well, there's been a lot of huffing and puffing in this debate, and some people have been sitting on the fence that much that they're liable to have splinters and sensitive parts of our anatomy. But let's hope we can, you know, we can move the bill through stage one tonight. First of all, tribute to Neil Bibby for getting these bills to this stage. There's a lot of work involved in bringing a members' bill forward. And members' bills can make, as I believe this one will do, can make a significant difference in local communities. So fair play to Neil Bibby and his team. Also pay tribute to Jamie Hepburn for engaging with Neil Bibby and also listening to the arguments that Mr. Bibby submitted and at least been prepared to let the bill progress through stage one, subject to parliamentary vote tonight. Gordon Lyndhurst set the kind of test with, you know, what are the consequences of the legislation? And other people have spoke about the balance of power between the kind of large pub co's and the tenants. And I think that's what gets to the fundamental test in this debate. And maybe I can give a practical example from a situation I was involved in an area close to where I stay. There had been a pub there that had been in a kind of similar form for the best part of 50 years, a successful community pub, well supported in the local area. It had like a lot of pubs, a local darts competition every Tuesday, Wednesday afternoons they had bingos for the pensioners, they had a pool room and etc. And that was all well received and well run locally. And Heineken Star Pubs, who have been mentioned in the debate, the owner of the pub decided that they wanted a different model and a different tenant, which was basically going to reconfigure the pub into like a pub restaurant. And this was resisted by the local campaigners, and Heineken met with them along with me, and they essentially resisted the campaigners' concerns that they didn't want to see the local pub format be lost. I realised that what Heineken were interested in was a profit motive, and they thought that they could reconfigure the pub and they'd modelled it on socio-economic factors in the area, and they thought they could get a different clientele in. And I tried to persuade them that business model wouldn't work, and they really had to work with the existing business model and maybe modernise some aspects of that. But they ignored the campaigners, they ignored me, they went ahead, and you know, lo and behold, people went to another pub. Sadly, some people didn't come back to the pub. You know, as Willie Rennie said, these pubs are community assets. And when I went by the pub of an evening, the new reconfigured pub, generally it was pretty empty. So that model was unsuccessful. And I tell that story to basically say that what Neil Bibby is seeking to achieve in a fairer balance of power between tenants and pub co's and only serves local areas better, serves the local economy better, and actually has got the potential to make pubs more successful. So I think there's a lot of good in this legislation. It will make a real difference. It will make a difference to staff, to customers, and it will also make the pubs run better themselves. So with that, I'm happy to support it at decision time coming up shortly.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kelly. I call Dean Lockhart to be followed by Jamie Hepburn. Dean Lockhart.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. This has been a lively debate, not just here in the Chamber, but this legislation has generated a lot of strong views across the pub sector over the past couple of months. While there is disagreement in the sector about the need for the legislation, there is, of course, widespread recognition that the pub sector is facing severe challenges. Graeme Simpson spoke about pubs being on their knees. A number of members during the debate have highlighted their concerns about the future of the sector, and industry bodies have warned that possibly two-thirds of hospitality businesses could go to the wall. But when it comes to the merits of this legislation, there are, as the Economy Committee has heard, deeply polarised views about whether, on the one hand, it will help the pub sector recover from COVID, or whether it could possibly further damage the sector. We've heard from those arguing in favour of the legislation, Neil Bibby, Daniel Johnson, Andy Whiteman, Willie Rennie, and others, who have told us they want to make sure the tenants are treated fairly, that they enjoy a fair share of the rewards of the business and are no worse off than free of tie tenants. In particular, they want the legislation to address concerns about the high cost of tied products, increased levels of rent, a lack of transparency, and examples of pub companies not complying with agreements. And Sarah Boyer highlighted the supply chain benefits that could potentially arise from the increasing number of small independent breweries emerging in Scotland being able to be put on a level playing field and for them to get their products better and easier into the marketplace. And it is clear that a number of organisations support the legislation, including the SLTA, the Campaign for Real Ale, and the Campaign for Pubs, amongst others. However, Presiding Officer, those against the legislation have also made a series of strong arguments. Concerns about the legislation will be costly and complex, and they point to the escalating costs of the Pub Code Adjudicator Office in England. They also point to the benefits of the existing tied pub model, which does allow tenants access to their own pub for a relatively small investment, while benefiting from economies of scale, and also of financial assistance, as we have seen during the COVID lockdowns. There are also benefits from the existing voluntary Scottish Pubs Code, which gives tenants many of the rights, which are included, I will in a second, which gives tenants many of the protections which are set out in the legislation without any risk to jobs or investment. I believe that Daniel Johnson wanted to intervene. I'll give way.
Daniel Johnson.
But if the member would acknowledge that landlords providing financial comfort to tenants through this crisis is not the exclusive preserve of this sector. Indeed, it's happened in retail and other. So it's somewhat of a bogus argument to say that only this type of commercial arrangement provides for that sort of ability for landlords to provide that comfort to tenants.
Dean Lockhart.
But that's a fair point. But if there is any risk that there would be a decline in landlords investing in the pubs in Scotland in the future, that financial support might not be there in the future. Presiding Officer, there are also concerns about the legislation in terms of the market rent option, which could give rise to significant levels of uncertainty about investment decisions in the future and making them harder to justify. So given these conflicting views coming from the sector, it's no surprise the Economy Committee came to no clear-cut view in their Stage 1 report. But we do need to progress this debate. And that's why, in concluding, I want to refer to the Federation of Small Business in their submission. They've called for a win-win outcome. And this win-win outcome for the sector must be the focus for those involved in the legislation going forward. Because if this legislation is going to work and to meet the needs of all players in the pub sector, it will have to be revised to meet the following key objectives. It must deliver a fair level of protection for tied tenants, provide more security for long-term investment, avoid the pitfalls and the costs of the system introduced in England, and perhaps most importantly, obtain buy-in from all parts of the sector so that everyone can work together and help our pubs emerge from the pandemic. There is time between now and Stage 2 of the bill to meet those objectives. We will support the bill at Stage 1 in order to explore whether these objectives can be achieved, and I would therefore urge Neil Bibby and the Minister to begin that work now. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lockhart. I call the Minister, Jamie Hepburn, to be followed by Neil Bibby. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll try and respond to as much of the debate as I have time to do. But first of all, let me start with an apology to Daniel Johnson. I am incredibly sorry I've not conformed to the low opinion that he holds of me and that I was hitherto unaware of. I'm sure we will get our relationship back on an even keel soon. Perhaps this is the beginning of it.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for giving me. Can I confirm that my opinion of him is quite transformed? Unfortunately, my poor sense of humour is not.
Minister.
Well, clearly, so is mine. I was only joking as well, Mr. Johnson. To turn to Andy Whiteman, he welcomed that I was not persuaded by the committee's recommendations, which I suppose is a fair observation in the absolute sense, but I should say, and I want to say to the committee, there was much in their report I had considerable sympathy with, one of those being the lack of independent and impartial analysis. That is something we did tried to undertake as a government back in 2016. And it has been difficult to try and get underneath the skin of much of the issues that have been raised. So I do understand the challenges the committee faced. And turning to Maurice Golden's remarks and speaking of that study in the 2016 study that he also spoke of, he suggested that was evidence against the bill. What that demonstrated, though, was the issue that I've just laid out, that it was difficult to get underneath the actual skin of the issue. We struggled to get engagement with that piece of work at the time. So the conclusion we reached wasn't so much that there wasn't a case for legislation per se, but that we would not be bringing forward legislation ourselves, and we haven't. However, Mr. Bibby has, and it is, as I said at the outset, incumbent on us to consider the bill before us. The issues that Maurice Golden raised around investment being a concern, as having been expressed by the pub companies, he's raised those entirely genuinely, I believe, and they are serious concerns. So in that sense, I want to set out, I am committed to continuing to engage with pub companies in the general sense about issues that affect their sector, and this specific issue of investment, and I should say, specific, should the bill become an Act of Parliament, specifically around any code that we would seek to develop. Briefly.
Andy Whiteman.
I thank the Minister for taking an intervention. He mentions this investment, and that's one of the issues that bedeviled the committee. I mean, for example, some of the investment that's made by pubcos by the is a discount on the beer, which is then multiplied by the volume and called investment. It was very, very unclear what the levels of investment were in pubcos, not least of which the amount of investment that was deemed to be withheld during the passage of this bill.
Yes, sir.
Well, of course, and that's part of the process of engagement with the pub companies, but the fact I'll engage with the pub companies isn't to the exclusion of the engagement I'll have with tenants and others interested in this matter. Picking up on the point that Sandra White raised, and I want to say to her, insofar as I understand and I've read the bill, there is nothing in the bill that compels any tenant to change the nature of tenure that they currently operate under. I should say, if that had been the case, then the Scottish Government would not be supporting the bill. Willie Rennie said that sometimes the sign of a good law is that if it isn't used that much, which it might be felt to be a counterintuitive observation, but it's actually, in this instance, one I share. One of the things I found persuasive in reaching the conclusion I have in respect of this bill was that some of those I spoke with, in their experience south of the border, despite there being few requests for the market rent option, or despite there being very few matters referred to the adjudicator, what the system has done has helped drive an improved relationship between the tenant and landlord. And I think Bob Doris effectively made that point as well. Graeme Simpson, it was right to say that there is a fine balance in arguments on this bill, but my judgment is we should tonight back this bill at stage one. But I must reiterate that the government's ongoing support for the bill is dependent on amendments at stage two to address the specific issues I laid out in opening. In closing, President Officer, I know that the conclusion that the Scottish Government has reached will be welcomed by many tenants, but less so by pub companies. And in that sense, I do think it is important to acknowledge their disappointment. And in acknowledging that, I commit to continue to work with them and with tenants and with Parliament, Mr. Bibby in particular, on this bill, but also more generally, to ensure that the pub sector in Scotland continues to be supported.
Thank you very much, Minister. And I call on Neil Bibby to close our debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank members who have spoken today for their helpful and constructive contributions. I'll try to deal with the points and the concerns that were made in the time that I have. I've always believed in a cross-party consensus on this bill was possible, and that's what I still want to achieve. I understand some members' views have evolved or are evolving, and I hope to convince everyone to vote for it by the time we get to stage three. We all care about our pubs in our communities, and as Willie Rennie said, they are important community assets. I'm willing to work across this chamber to make this bill a success. I'm willing to engage with the Scottish Government and with all parties through the amending stages to improve the bill in a way that is consistent with its fundamental aims. I thank the Minister for his remarks. I understand the reasons why it took time for him to reach a decision, but the decision he made was the right one, and I know it will be warmly welcomed by tenants. With the leadership he has shown today, I believe that statutory rights and protections for Scotland's tide pub tenants are now within sight. I do want to respond to Maurice Golden's contribution. Maurice Golden reminded us that 93% of responses to my consultation supported the bill. I accept it's not a scientific study, but as Sarah Boyack and others said, look at who responded to the bill at the consultation and committee stage: the Scottish Licensed Trade Association, the GMB Scotland, Federation of Small Business Scotland, CAMRA, to name just a few. The point is that the majority of committee evidence supported the bill too, including 93% of those who took part in an independent and confidential committee survey of tenants. Maurice Golden says the only study conducted in Tide pubs was the Scottish Government's CGA study. That's wrong. CGA conducted the same survey that I quoted from in my opening speech, a study of 200 Scottish tenants, a study that found only 3% of tenants had a positive sentiment towards their tie. I also refer him and others to the evidence of the Scottish Licensed Trade Association when they gave evidence to the committee in which they said pubs had insufficient reserves to deal with COVID precisely because of the Tide model. This issue might not seem the biggest issue to everyone, I accept that, but as Daniel Johnson and others said, to those who have been exploited, to those who are still being exploited, and to the 750 tenanted businesses, the law governing the tie is of fundamental importance. And this is not just about numbers, this is about the principle. And I would still argue 750 tie pubs is a significant number of businesses in Scotland. I've never claimed this bill is a panacea. I've never claimed this bill will solve all the problems of all pubs, but it will make a difference. I also want to make clear that if tenants are happy with their Tide agreement, make that clear to Sandra White, if tenants are happy with their Tide agreement, then the bill allows it to continue. Equally, if the Tide model is as robust and as fair as the pub codes say, then there'd be no reason for anyone to report them to the adjudicator. And my argument is not that the tie should be abolished in all cases. My argument is simply that Tide agreements must be fair, and tenants don't need to exercise MRO rights should they not wish to do so. And the levy proposed will fall on the pub companies, not individual publicans. Lawson Mount Stevenson, the managing director of Star Bars and Pubs, said in the Times today that this bill is unwarranted. Star Bars is owned by Heineken, the second biggest brewer in the world, who made over €800 million profit in the first half of the year. Certainly more than our Tide publicans. What he forgets to say that is his company was just fined £2 million for repeated breaches of the pub codes for England and Wales. And still pub code lobbyists say this bill tries to solve a problem that doesn't exist. They speak with no credibility on this issue whatsoever. There is divided opinion. Scotland's publicans do want to know whose side this Parliament is on. The Tide pub tenants, the small businesses working day in, day out, the consumers who want choice at the bar, the workers who understand that reform can open Tide pubs up to our brewing industry, or the pubcos, the multinational extracting more than their fair share from the Scottish economy. In voting for this bill, Parliament is siding with the creators, the innovators and the grafters who make our pubs so special. We are standing up for the little guy. We're standing up for small businesses and for Scottish workers, not offshore pubcos, hedge funds and global brewing giants. Presiding officer, I read the other day someone lobbying for the pubcos saying this bill makes them want to cry. But it's what they're doing to publicans that should make them want to cry. Publicans putting their heart and soul into a business and struggling to make the minimum wage. Publicans amassing mountains of debt because their Tide deal unravels. Publicans who can't make a decent living out of a profitable pub because so much wealth is extracted so unfairly. That should make them want to cry. Presiding officer, this bill is fundamentally about fairness, choice and jobs. Fairness for Tide tenants, choice for consumers and action to protect jobs in Scotland's pubs and Scotland's brewing industries. It allows Scotland's publicans to keep more of the profit their pubs make in the Scottish economy and gives the leverage they need to get a fairer deal. For all those reasons, I ask the Parliament to support the bill today. Thank you, President.
Thank you very much. And that concludes our debate on the Tide Pub Scotland Bill. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 23500 on committee membership. Could I call in Miles Briggs on behalf of the Bureau to move this motion?
Formally moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. So we're going to turn to decision time. The first question this evening is the amendment 23481.2 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, which seeks to amend motion 23481 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on making Scotland equally safe, marking the annual International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, be agreed. Are we agreed? We are agreed. The next question is that amendment 23481.1 in the name of Rhoda Grant, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville, be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And the next question is that motion 23481... Rachel Hamilton was agreed. So our next question is that motion 23481 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on making, as amended, on making Scotland equally safe, marking the annual International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Now the next question is that motion 23343 in the name of Neil Bibby on the Tide Pubs Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes. No.
We're not agreed. We're going to move to a vote, and because we need to vote, we're going to suspend Parliament for a few moments while members access the voting app. So Parliament is suspended for a few moments. Thank you, colleagues. We are going to resume the session and we're going to move straight to the vote. So the question is that motion 23343 in the name of Neil Bibby on the Tidebub Scotland Bill be agreed and members be cast their votes now. This will be a 1 minute division. That vote is now closed. I would ask any member who believes they were not able to register the vote to let me know through a point of order, either here in the chamber or online. The result of the vote on motion 23343 in the name of Neil Bibby is yes 107, no 0. There were 4 abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. Now our final question this evening is that Parliamentary Bureau motion 23500 in the name of Graham Day on committee membership be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And that concludes decision time. Thank you very much. I close this meeting.